Blog Talk Radio.
Down one of these times, but it actually cuts off right then, so I can come in at the close of action. Hello, everyone, and this is the Radulich and Broadcasting Network Movie Review Club Group Loose Association. Guys who bump into each other every now and then. I'll flesh that joke out later. I'm Robert Winfree, and thanks, everybody, for tuning in. Tonight, Mark Radulich and I are back. Took a couple of weeks off because nothing came out that either of us really wanted to talk about. I mean, I saw The Revenant, but Mark didn't, and I didn't care enough to find someone else who did to review it with, so we just enjoyed the time off, and tonight we are back in the saddle, and we are reviewing Kung Fu Panda 3. Yay. Sorry. I'm definitely having a bit of an unenthused week so far, so my apologies. That's our a few notes about the format of the show that have changed starting today. That bit of music you heard, that is the intro for Hooray for Hollywood, is now going to be our standard intro. We're not going to be utilizing music from the film we're reviewing, because Mark likes to put these things on YouTube, and YouTube hates its users, and is more than happy to infringe on all kinds of potential fair use agreements in favor of, you know, the people who created it. Plus, since theoretically we could get paid for this, we're not, but we could. It is used in something that could be commercially viable. They would be entitled to a portion of the proceeds. And that just creates a whole complicating issue that we don't want to get into. So for the sake of simplicity, that's the direction we're going in. And we're going to close with, instead of necessarily the same segment where Mark reads reviews and I bang my head against the wall weeping about the fate of humanity, we decided to add a bit of a new little wrinkle. We're going to talk about the box office weekend, because now it's Wednesday. We have hard numbers from, you know, whatever came out last week. Talk about who won, who overperformed, who underperformed, just real briefly kind of touch on stuff like that. We're playing with the format. We want to make this, you know, a more... Yeah, kind of an all-inclusive thing, just not just the two of us kind of yakking the whole time. We need format. We need, you know, a bit of a schedule, a bit of structure, and we're all going to be better off for it. All right, I've yakked long enough. Let me bring him on, the man behind all of those aforementioned changes, because really, I'm just here to look pretty. Mark Radulich. Mark, how you doing?
Oh, you're so pretty. You're so very pretty. So witty and pretty and gay. It's your fault, by the way. I just did that. Now listen.
Sure.
I missed you, Mr. Winfrey. I mean, I know we still talk online. You still comment on things, and you certainly played the home game. We talked about Lord of the Rings last week, 2 weeks ago. But yeah, whenever we do these, I enjoy them, and we haven't done them in a couple of weeks, and I missed it. I'm glad we're back in the saddle again.
Now, I just really wish I had that sound bite from that song, but I don't have it. So, opportunity missed. Oh, well.
I can guarantee you, though, we will still occasionally read reviews.
It's not going away, folks. So, for those of you
who
live for the moment when I smash my head against the wall going, why, God, why?
The only thing that has been taken away is no longer starting. I don't want to go every week with having to change the music. And yeah, I upload these things on YouTube, so I don't want to keep messing around with the music, because then YouTube throws pies at my face. No, in addition to reading reviews when I think that the moment calls for it, because that was some of the most fun times we had last year, with me reading reviews and you contemplating killing yourself. that was hilarious. But no, we'll do that.
You almost put me back into therapy.
We'll talk about that plus who won the weekend. We ended the year last year with a review of what studios did what, and you know, and it was a lot of homework and catch up on our part, because we really hadn't paid that close attention to it all year round, except, you know, to tweak Gavin Napier's nipples every once in a while. This year, I'd actually like to pay attention to it. So we'll be doing that as a weekly part of our show. Other than that, I'm doing fine.
I'm glad you're doing fine. Alrighty. Let's go ahead and jump into this. Kung Fu Panda 3. Man, who would have thought? I mean, I know DreamWorks is kind of hard up for content sometimes, and they're still desperately trying to recreate Shrek being able to make 86 films and 24 television spinoffs that made everyone want to find Mike Myers and throttle him. But I would not have pegged Kung Fu Panda as the next, you know, kind of tentpole franchise for DreamWorks. But here we are.
That's a good place as any of us for me to pick an argument with you. Why would you say that? Jack Black's a thing. And, you know, it's a funny idea. A fat panda performing kung fu.
Was great for one movie.
But it wasn't great for just one movie. The second one was plenty good as well. And this third one is also good. Trying not to be overly complimentary, but I think people have really, certainly people have gone out and seen them. They've made money. Excuse me.
Of all the things DreamWorks has done, you know, for us to get essentially the same gag running for three movies just kind of surprised me a little bit.
I think you're being too hard on the beaver there, sir. I don't feel like it's been the same yet. I think they started with your typical story of, you know, the schlub who wants to be greater than he really is, and then, you know, he's put into a situation that he's not ready for, and he rises to the challenge and he becomes a hero. And then the continuation of that was learning more about himself.
Put in a situation where he's supposed to be greater than he is, and he rises to the occasion again at the last possible minute. And then in this one where, again, he is still, yet again, placed in a position where he must rise to the occasion at the last possible minute.
Well, this one's a little bit different, because as my social studies teacher used to say, in order to really own something, you have to be able to teach it. And, you know, and he's, at this point, he's just been following the lead of his teacher over and over and over again. And when he's told, you know, in order for you to transition into, here's the thing, this really touches me, because I believe in the idea of making yourself uncomfortable and having to, you know, be better than you are. You have to, you know, you have to push yourself into these uncomfortable situations and really test yourself. You'll never know how good you can be until you try. And I think that was one of the points of the movie, which, I mean, you know, you're going to do your plot synopsis in just a moment. But see, this is what I say. I think it's easy to sort of blow these off as, oh, this is stupid kids' fare. But I actually think the writers on all three Kung Fu Pandas, gags included, were not as silly kid fare as you're making it out to be. However, if you really want to complain about something, complain about this. The Three Stooges is getting a preteen reboot.
And now I want to kill myself again.
The search is on for three 12-year-old boys to play pint-sized versions of Larry
Just
Moe and
stop.
Tony.
Just stop.
Here. Do you have your messenger on?
I believe you when you say that that's a thing. I really do.
All right, we'll talk about that another time.
Why? God, and to give them child actors, and this includes 90% of teenage actors, suck. They just suck. That's why you find 20-year-olds who you can make look younger. That's a terrible idea. Terrible.
So the plot, sir. Now that I've yelled at you for complaining too much.
Oh, I have not yet begun to complain. All right. This movie picks up not too long after the second one ends. Master Sifu, played by Dustin Hoffman, excuse me, announced that he is retiring from teaching and passing that role on to Poe so that Dustin Hoffman's character can master Chi. Because he can't do that while he's trying to teach Poe, because Poe constantly interrupts, as he's wont to do. Around that same time, in the spirit world, Master Oogway's long-lost best friend, who has totally been a thing throughout all three movies. God, that honestly, that one bothered me about as much as Christoph Waltz and freaking Spectre. No, yeah, it was me. The whole time it was me. Like, no! God, just why? Why? Anyway, his long-lost friend, who he turned on, they had a tiff over the proper use of chi, and this guy's name is Kai. He steals Master Oogway's chi, which is his life force, his energy. He has captured all of the life essence of all the Kung Fu masters that have died and passed over into the spirit world. He now has enough power to return to the mortal realm and begin wreaking terror. There's a bit of a running gag about how nobody knows who he is.
Which,
he deserves so much better. And won an Oscar. Anyway, so he decides he wants to wipe out the memory and the work of Oogway because Oogway destroyed his memory. That is, it's a throwaway line. Look, Kai is the least developed, just flat-out worst villain of all three of these movies, which is sad because he could be so cool, but no. No time is spent with him. He is just a mustache-twirly McBad guy, as Mark said. That's all he is. But he has tons of power with his chi. He has jade zombies that he summons. And to defeat him, Poe must learn the power of chi, must, you know, become a master of chi. Well, he also ran into his biological father, played by Bryan Cranston, who also deserves better. There is a funny gag when they meet each other, though, that I want to talk about in a minute. He takes Poe to the long-lost panda village where bunch of pandas living in secret to ostensibly teach him the power of chi by getting him to reconnect with his nature as a panda. This includes sleeping past noon, eating with your fists, eating with your hands as much as you can at a time, rolling down hills instead of walking. And nobody likes stairs, so they have giant slingshots that move them uphill. There's some funny gags in there. Turns out, no, his dad doesn't know chi. Pandas lost that ability not too long after they were massacred by Shen, I guess, from the second movie. So, he got brought there on a lie. He and his dad have a fight, like you do in these types of movies. He decides to confront Kai anyway. He winds up teaching all of the pandas how to fight, utilizing their basic abilities, so they develop catapults out of their slingshots that they can launch each other at. There's a guy who's obsessed with hugs who he teaches to crush spines. You guys are great at hacky sack, so here's these little fireworks that you can kick at people once they're lit and they will explode in their faces. Stuff like that. Which is actually rather intelligent given that, you know, Poe kind of sucks as a teacher, so when it comes to teaching straight kung fu, so let's modify it, let's find the bent for it. It's an extension of basically what Master Sifu did with him in the first one. I can't train you the way I trained everyone else, so I'm going to motivate you with food. Which is a great idea for a panda. He winds up having a final showdown with Kai in the spirit world, where everyone back in the real world sends him portions of their chi. He becomes superpowered, summons a giant dragon that he uses to fight Kai, then he winds up overloading Kai with chi, because Kai's whole thing is, I want to steal all the chi. So he gives him more than he can handle, and every one of those stories. Every single one of these where somebody wants something like that, at the end, they get overloaded with it. Every single time. They could not have possibly telegraphed that more. Just saying. Over that 5-minute fight with Kai, he has now become a true master of chi. Something that took, you know, others decades to learn. 5 minutes, he's got it.
He's the Dragon Warrior. It makes sense.
Sure. I'm not going to complain too much about that one. He returns to the mortal world, now a master of chi with a funky cape. Shifu, his reaction to that, hey, where'd you get that staff? Oh, Oogway gave it to me. Of course he did. I think I'm a master of chi now, too. Of course you are. I got a kick out of that one. The movie ends with him overseeing training everyone in the Jade Palace. The pandas have now reintegrated into society. And that will be the jumping off point for the next 3 movies, I assume. Because they're planning 3 more.
Let me first talk about my observations, my thoughts, and how the experience went for my family and I. So at the drive-in, my wife and I really liked it. I liked the story that it told. I thought it brought him full circle, Poe, that is. I liked the relationship with the dad, and I thought, you know, finding your roots as a panda, yes, there were gags in it that was funny, but I mean, ultimately, the object lesson here was, you know, be yourself and, you know, find what's good about you and use it to your advantage, basically. And I like that. You know, J.K. Simmons as Kai is fine. He's just sort of there to be a bad guy. He's more like a video game boss than he is really a character.
Yeah, there's nothing to that character at all. And it's sad because
The movie is pretty much on Jack Black's shoulders. And, you know, while I'm not the biggest Jack Black fan, I think he does a great job of his character. I think he really brings it to life. He plays it with enthusiasm.
Without him, whoever decided to cast Jack Black as Poe made one of the best decisions they could have possibly made. His enthusiasm and fanboyism and ability to generate the right amount of emotion when the moment calls for it has been, it's the entirety of this series. With anyone else in that voice role, the first one probably fails, and we don't even have the other two to talk about.
My daughter, who was able to appreciate the movie more than my son did, my daughter is 5, my son is almost 2. My daughter's reaction was she liked Tigress and the Ribbon Girl.
Of course.
Take that for what you will. But my wife and I really thought the story was solid. And we were definitely entertained by it. My son liked it when there was fighting. The rest of the time he spent jumping all over the car.
Yeah, that sounds like a 2-year-old.
Sorry. Go ahead.
No, I just said that sounds like a 2-year-old is all.
So that being said, I enjoyed the final the idea of the final conflict. Spoiler alert. You know, if you've been listening to us long enough, you know, we don't hold anything back. So I like the idea of him sacrificing himself in order to take Kai out of the village into the spirit world, where he had a distinct disadvantage until he figured out how to use chi. And as far as the sudden ability to use chi and all that, I mean, look, for a kid's movie where you know the good guys are going to win, I thought there was a sufficient amount of tension, dramatic tension. I thought if you turned your brain off long enough and you weren't looking to piss all over the movie, the villagers and everybody coming together, sort of getting over a lot of their own internal stuff, like the father, the duck father, sorry, goose father,
goose.
Getting over his own aggravation at dealing, you know, his own fear really of losing Poe to his birth dad, you know, the birth dad's guilt over lying to him, the, you know, individual issues with each character, Tigress's issue with him. When they all kind of got over that and they gave them, you know, his chi, I thought it was a genuinely moving moment. You know, and so it was ultimately satisfying when yes, they did the old standard, you know, you want all my power, take, you know, you want my power, take it all, you know, in the butt. And then the guy explodes.
You have an unhealthy fixation with that.
There's nothing unhealthy about being fixated on in the butt. anywho. So, yeah, I thought it was a very satisfying episode. It was actually very cool. I will tell you this. The animation and the backdrops are splendid looking. They really, really are very nice. I would say not as good as The Good Dinosaur, which I think is right now the standard bearer. But, you know, it was definitely pretty. It was a very pretty film to watch.
Yeah, this isn't, you know, hackneyed animation. The guys who, you know, do this for a living over at DreamWorks have a good feel for the visual aesthetic they're working in, how to do it, how to make it look good. There were some interesting shifts in style. They go from traditional CGI to what looks almost hand-drawn, kind of, traditional anime style every now and then for a couple of different sequences. Which is a nice visual change of pace. They've done that before in some of the other ones, but again, they did it again here, and it works very well. Again, one of my big things, I've mentioned this before, I think a story without a compelling villain tends to fall flat in various aspects, and you've got J.K. Simmons, who is not just a great actor, but has proven that he can be a good voice actor. And there's a substantial difference. I mean, a lot of good actors struggle when they just have their voices to work with. And Simmons has proven...
Go ahead, finish, but I want to
say... I mean, Simmons has proven that he can handle just straight voice acting. I think it was Jeff Harris who mentioned that in this case, though, not only is the character of Kai written very flatly, Simmons never quite finds the right voice for him. He's seems to fall back on his version of J. Jonah Jameson a bit too often in terms of vocal patterns and voice tenor. And I mean, he has one of the coolest weapons. Anyone who's played God of War knows exactly how awesome those, you know, blades on a chain can be. But he's not really a character. They don't, his whole character is an afterthought. The story they want to tell is the story they actually do tell, which is Poe's reconciliation with his biological father, coming to grips with himself, you know, all that stuff. And when they tell that story, the movie is perfectly successful.
Here's my defense of the Kai character. Well, I don't think the character in and of itself is fleshed out very well. I think the character is sort of one note. Like I said, he's more of a video game boss. I think
he shows up, and I am going to rule the world by capturing all of your chi. Why? Because I found out chi existed.
Well, okay, but here's my defense of him. I think internally, like, if you are one of those characters, he does represent a substantial amount of dread. When he, you know, he shows up and he's nigh invincible through most of the movie.
Nigh invincible, but nobody knows who he is.
Okay, but still,
I mean, they all
most of the third act here.
Hang on, for compare and contrast purposes, the very notion that Tai Lung would get out of jail in the first one panics the village. Just the mention of his name in that context causes everyone to freak out. Here's this guy who's, you know, theoretically exponentially more powerful, has bested all of these masters, and the gag is no one knows his name. Once he gets going, it's okay. There's a bit of dread, but it just falls so flat. Everything involving him falls flat.
I think watching the characters in the third act react to him attacking the Panda Village, there's a substantial amount of dread to create tension. And I think, while it would have been nice of him to give you a real character with some real motivations and not just I want chi because, you know, I'm essentially Pac-Man eating pellets. I at least like the fact that he represented a real threat to the characters in the movie. Such to the point that your main character had to sacrifice himself and risk death by taking him into the spirit world. So, I mean, you know, could they have done a little bit more with him? Sure, but I don't know. I think if I'm a kid, if I'm the audience for this movie, I'm not really interested in his story anyway.
Well, you don't have to get deep into it. He doesn't need an extended monologue, but it's just the character was an afterthought. It was like they wrote the story about Poe becoming, you know, one with his pandaness and, you know, and reconnecting with that part of who he is, and then that's a great story, but this is a kid's movie about Kung Fu, so we need a villain. And they pulled one out of a stockpile.
A villain on a stick.
I just imagine there's this, like a giant bookshelf full of, you know, very thinly drawn characters that they can just reach up to blindly and pull one out, and here, this one goes in.
Just pull it off the villain tree.
Yeah. Why not?
Angelina Jolie's performance as Tigress, I barely realize she's ever in the movie. Like, the Tigress character is fine, but I can hardly ever tell that's Angelina Jolie.
I'm actually okay with that because it, you know, is a hallmark of adequate voice acting that you can camouflage necessarily.
Yeah, but I don't think she does anything special with the character. That was more of why.
None of them do. Look, these, I wonder to the degree that these have become vanity projects for Jack Black, because they're shelling out money for Angelina Jolie, Lucy Liu, Bryan Cranston, Seth Rogen, who, for some reason, commands a price tag.
I don't think Jackie Chan ever gets any lines in this, by the way.
He does, because he's monkey.
He does get a line or two.
Yeah, the point is, you're paying these people probably an exorbitant amount of money for the work you're getting, and you're utilizing their name value to try and draw people in, rather than actually doing anything with them. I mean, there are three characters that actually get development in this movie. Poe, Lee, and the Goose, whose character name I cannot remember.
All right, that's something to talk about. I really liked the Goose character. I love the fact that, you know, he loves Poe, and that he really felt hurt by the idea of Poe having another father and him having to sort of reconcile his relationship with Poe and where he fits in after this discovery, and sort of, you know, allowing it to happen, not interfering with Poe, and knowing that he's still part of the family. I enjoyed that part of it.
That was very well done. I mean, it makes sense for the character. It's well written. You get a few good laughs out of it, like him trying to keep the horde of baby pandas out of his food.
Oh, my wife and I had a good laugh, and we sort of cheered at the end where they had, you know, double father attack.
That was good.
I enjoyed that. It's got an 80% on the tomato meter, and 89% of the audience liked it.
That's about right.
Yeah.
I mean, again, if we're grading this pass-fail, it's a pass.
Let's see. What are some of the... We have 16 rotten reviews.
Before we get into that, I wonder if you have any favorite gags from this, because I have like three that I wanted to talk about that I thought were funny.
Okay, well, my favorite gag, unfortunately, was in the commercial, and we've been and I have to talk about this.
All right.
My wife and I were watching the commercial for Kung Fu Panda, and she was sort of excited about seeing it. I mean, we wouldn't normally go see these kinds of movies, you know, just by ourselves, but, you know, with kids and everything, blah blah, yakety smackety, ampersand, etc. That being said, we were watching the commercial, and he does the bit with the noodle squadron and eat the noodles. Okay, what's the next
dumpling
one?
Dumpling squad will be over here, and
they eat the dumpling.
Points his bamboo stick, and the kid eats the stick.
Right. And my wife looks at it, she's like, Jesus Christ, I'm a panda. and ever since then, I've been calling her, I've been referring to her as part of the Noodle Squadron. And we had a really good laugh about that.
Oh, I had one gag that I laughed at more than I should have because I have a different association with it. But
okay,
I think
did it have anything to do with the Ribbon Girl?
No.
By the way, Kate Blanchett, holy cow. No, not Kate Blanchett. Kate Hudson, holy cow with that character. I was pretty impressed with it. I mean, like, I think they were originally going to get the fat British chick or Australian chick from Pitch Perfect, who's in everything now. And I'm kind of glad because I don't really find her that great of an actress. But Kate Hudson really just owned that part and made it fun.
I'll give you that. I thought the character was kind of a waste and that you introduce her, you know, potentially being interested in Poe romantically. And then after her debut ribbon dance, she kind of fades into the background with everybody else.
Well, Jesus Christ, it's only a 90-minute production here, an hour and 40 minutes. How many subplots did you want to put in this?
I'm just saying. You could have extended this thing's runtime by 10 minutes.
No, you couldn't.
And fleshed out at least one character.
Absolutely not. I was in the audience with the children. They were all wanting this thing to come to an end. This is not Lord of the Rings.
That's why I'm only asking for 10 minutes, not another movie.
10 minutes, it's a lifetime.
It's not a lifetime, it's not even close.
Mimi was just fine.
May.
She did her thing, and then she used the ribbons to attack Kai. It was fine.
Yeah, I agree, it was fine. It's just odd that they throw in a couple of new things that amount to nothing.
Well, here's the thing. You know, they have more to explore, and that's in the next movie. Yes, she showed some interest in him, but ultimately this was about him connecting to the entire, you know, being a panda. There's no time in this for love, Dr. Jones.
Short round.
You know, we're already developing Lee Bryan Cranston's character. We still have to deal with the other characters in the movie who have stuff going on. And then there's our villain. So really, Mimi had to take a backseat. I was fine with it.
Again, my whole thing at that point is just, are you actually accomplishing anything by introducing this character?
I mean, they accomplish the same thing they accomplish by having the guy that, you know, that hugs too hard. You know, the Lenny of the pandas.
All right, sure.
I kept waiting for him to say, tell me about the rabbits.
That would have been good. No, I think probably my favorite gag from this movie was when the first time Lee and Poe meet. Because nobody's going to beat my dumpling eating record, and then no, this other panda did, and they gasp and look at each other. No, I lost my son. Oh, I lost my father. Oh, well, good luck with that. Yeah, good luck to you as well. They both turn and they like start leaving, and the entire audience in the restaurant face palms. And then they both get their realization and that, no, wait, really? But the delayed reaction to it I thought was hilarious. I'm not going to lie, because I laughed at Master Chicken.
Yes, well, as well you should have.
Because I can only think Clucky finally got his due.
Any other gags that you like to say? Like I said, I love the Noodle Squadron bit. I thought that was hilarious. I enjoyed the various fight-back tactics that the pandas used. I like he finally becomes the dragon warrior, and that is meaningful in some way by him actually having a dragon made of chi. So I liked all of that. excuse me. As far as other gags go, I just thought the whole thing was, let's celebrate being fat, by the way. Watching this, that was something I said to my wife. I was just like, this whole thing is a commercial for love yourself if you're a big fat fatty.
I'm not going to lie. I feel like all of the panda interactions were like co-authored by Seth MacFarlane. If you've never seen the episode of Family Guy where Peter realizes he's fat and like founds the Association for Fat People with the sub rule of no fat chick.
Pow, right in the kisser.
He's running into James Woods.
Okay. So there are 80... Go ahead.
The last thing I want to touch on is... Cause we talked a little bit about this. But I agree with you about, you know, the Goose Dad. You know, the way he reacts and he's written. I had a lot of fun with him. I don't know how much of the writing this was and how much this was just Bryan Cranston being awesome, but when he has to kind of explain to Poe what happened, it was one of those moments that I'm trying... The only other kind of comparable moment, and this is very weird, I know, but bear with me. There's a similar... I get a similar vibe from a scene in the first Expendables movie when Mickey Rourke explains... just narrates a scene from his past to Sylvester Stallone. It's just such a great bit of acting and so tonally different from the rest of the movie that it almost feels like it doesn't belong. Yet it not that it doesn't, but it almost feels out of place, but everything around it is meshes with it so well that it just serves as this great enhancer to the entire experience. And him talking about, oh yeah, I had a great life, I had it all, and then having to kind of go through, you know, losing everything and where his head's been at, it's a really well done bit of both writing and acting. And that's the only other thing I wanted to really point out, because again, that it's pretty clear to me that's the story they were focused on telling, and it shows because it's told so very well, and all the other stuff is just kind of an afterthought.
Yeah, I would say for the most part, these are not throwaway performances, but people who really, you know, dug into their parts and performed them well. But like I said, Angelina Jolie, I don't know if it's just the way the character's written or her choice as an actor, but I don't feel like she does anything with the role. She just sort of reads, she's just tigress and she reads the lines, and she's cool to watch and not very interesting beyond that.
Oh, most of the five are like that. I mean, Seth Rogen gets an occasional laugh out of jokes, but that's because he's Mantis. And you know, look, it's an insect. There's endless fodder for comedy here.
So there were 82 critic reviews in total on Rotten Tomatoes and 16 rotten ones out of 82. So here's Catherine Pusgar from the New York Daily News. She is a top critic. Unfortunately, I apologize. I have some coughing issues tonight. Unfortunately, looks aren't everything. The plot is plotting and predictable. All right.
I would agree, but at the same time, it's a kid's movie. There's only so much innovation to be done.
Alan Scherstuhl from The Village Voice, another top critic. In studio movies, especially for children, all it takes to be great at something difficult is a good heart and a training montage. Go on, America. Keep yelling at Common Core while parking your kids in front of this stuff. Oh, God.
All right. He's right. B, this is the entirely wrong platform for you to try and launch your social commentary through, sir.
Okay, Roger Moore of Movie Nation, winded, out of ideas, and laughs.
I disagree with winded. But as far as out of ideas, out is not necessarily accurate, but it's very, this is all very familiar territory.
Peter Hartlob, top critic at the San Francisco Chronicle, says, Kung Fu Panda 3 has a moment or two for everyone, but no chance to develop any character beyond a single dimension. The next scene has often arrived before the viewer can process the last one.
And again, we've arrived at a fundamental disagreement, because there's at least three characters that get some dimension to them. Poe continues to be fleshed out. His Goose Dad and his Panda Dad both have arcs. I mean, sure, everyone else is all static, but Those are the main characters relative to the story they're telling. So yeah, they're gonna get priority.
It is a good one. From the Boston Globe, the whole fightin' bear jamboree is agreeable enough, but it takes some of the spotlight away from black being black and doesn't jive with messages about having a sense of self of what makes you you.
Yeah.
Really? I disagree with that entirely.
I'm trying to see where he's coming from here is all.
Well, let's break this down. It takes some of the spotlight away from black being black. Really? Because he's the focal point of the whole goddamn movie. And I don't really need 140 minutes of just Jack Black.
We'd really rather not have that, all things considered.
And doesn't time with messages about having a sense of self or what makes you you. The whole point of the movie. I don't really know where he's coming from with that.
Yeah, I don't think that's a valid criticism. The whole point is he's never been a panda amongst other pandas. That's what he's leaving to do.
Right. So here's my favorite one. Are you ready? This is from
sure.
The Toronto Sun. Good old Liz Braun, who I'm guessing wasn't very good at math when she was in school. Way too talky and overcomplicated.
All right. That sound you might have just heard was my aneurysm rupturing.
Not entirely sure what was overcomplicated about this plot. Again,
about as simplistic as you can get.
I can't even think of a movie.
I'm sorry,
like
have
that.
You suffered brain damage? I mean, if you consider SpongeBob to be the appropriate amount of dialogue to goofiness, then sure, this is overlong and talky. But for those of us with fully functioning brains,
you should apply to this rock, son.
Why? just why?
All right. So who won the weekend? Well, obviously Kung Fu Panda did.
It won big.
with an estimated $41 million, Kung Fu Panda 3 crushed the previous January animated opening weekend record of $19.5 million, which was held by The Nut Job in 2014. Oh, I told Lily to go see The Nut Job. I can see why this beat it. It's also bordering on enough to become the second largest January opening of all time, just shy of Ride Along's $41.5 million from 2014. Compared to
it's
the first
got a worldwide box office of $127 million.
Yep. Compared to the first two Panda films, the opening doesn't signify yet another drop-off following the original film's $60.2 million and Kung Fu Panda 2's $47.6 million. But with an A cinema score and not another animated release until March 4th, Zootopia, it has a month and a half. It has a month all to itself to take in the animated family dollar.
Yeah, this thing's gonna be fine. There's really not a whole lot of competition for what it's trying to do. Let me see. I need to double check. Oh. That explains that, actually. I was just looking over the credits for this. I forgot that Hans Zimmer does the music for these.
And that does an excellent job.
Hans Zimmer's awesome.
So Kung Fu Panda came in at number one with the weekend gross of $41 million. I think it had already been out in China, so it's already at, like I said, 100 and some odd something million. The Revenant came in at number two at $12 million. Star Wars earned another $11 million to come in at number three. And The Finest Hour, which made its debut this weekend, the Walt Disney period piece featuring the Coast Guard and Chris Pine, so far has made worldwide $13,779,646. And it came in at number four, I believe. I don't have a production budget here, but...
It's unconfirmed, somewhere in the $70 to $80 million range.
Well, that's not good.
this is a big disappointment.
if Disney's having a rough time with its not, you know, with its non-intellectual property features. I mean, last year, you know, we talked forever about Tomorrowland, and that was, you know, the big summer release.
Finest Hours has a 59% rating on Rotten Tomatoes.
I would say this was a bust.
Yeah, that's going to be a loss for Disney this year. But they've got Avengers movies coming out, so they don't care.
Yeah, well, they've got Avengers, they've got Rogue One. They'll be fine. And Disney, you know, Walt Disney's not going out of business. But yeah, they definitely did not start off on the right foot here with the Finest Hours. And rounding out the top five was Ride Along 2, which currently holds at $89 million on a budget of 40. So it's doing, you know, just fine. Kevin Hart, despite Robert Winfrey's opinion on the matter, does just fine in the movies. People like him to go see his stuff.
Yeah, you'll never go broke appealing to the lowest common denominator.
And 50 Shades of Black, which I believe also came out this past weekend, comes in at number 10. Again, no budget numbers, but
fortunately, it seems people have started cluing into the fact that the Wayans Brothers movies generally suck.
This thing so far, the weekend gross was $5 million, $5,900,528, and it hasn't been released worldwide yet, so that was a total gross.
The budget appears to be round about $5 million.
Okay, well, at least it made its budget.
You got to double your budget to actually be profitable.
They'll probably
make a bit of money, but hopefully the Wayans brothers will stop making crappy parody movies. The world doesn't need more of them.
Okay, yeah, it's currently holding in a $7.2 million box office with a budget of $5 million. And I believe...
So if nobody sees it for the rest of its theatrical run, it will lose money.
And
please,
it's got
people, I beg you, don't go see this.
Well, it's already got a 10% on Rotten Tomatoes, so I don't think it's doing well.
Well, movies like that never do well critically.
All right, so next week in theaters... we've got The Choice by Lionsgate, which is a drama romance. Nobody I know of any significance in this. Oh, okay, I know which one this is. This is the one they've been advertising on TV where the people are flirting together and the girl's in the hospital at some point. Dad's Army, which is a wartime comedy directed by Oliver Parker.
That movie's a lot of nothing. The
right.
Big release for this coming week is Hail Caesar,
which we aren't reviewing. we're gonna review the horror comedy based on the novel put out by Screen Gems, Pride and Prejudice, and Zombies.
Even zombies cannot make Jane Austen palatable.
I think this has already got reviews on Rotten Tomatoes, and they're not good.
Of course not. Look, I've mentioned this in the past. I'll mention this again right now about this movie. This is one of those movies that tries to be a good bad movie. And believe it or not, that's not a quality you can necessarily plan for.
Well, it's
good.
It's projected
good,
to gross 10 to 12 million.
By accident.
They're looking for a 10 to 12 million dollar gross this weekend. I'm going to see it Friday night after work. It's got a 48% on Rotten Tomatoes, so this ought to be fun.
That will go down.
And the budget's 28 million. So we'll see how it does overall over the course.
There's a reason they stuck it in the dumping ground that is February.
The week before Deadpool. which apparently has test audiences howling in the aisles.
Of course, because people don't... Look, the first time you see the character of Deadpool, you think he's hilarious. You think he's hot buttered popcorn and you can't get enough. The second time you realize, no, this is crap. You're a one-note, hackneyed character that was designed to appeal to insiders and smarks in the comic book world. And I find Deadpool to be a fundamentally underdeveloped character. He is a one-note gag. How many ways and in how many times and in how many ways can I break the fourth wall?
Guess we'll find out.
If you do not like Ryan Reynolds playing another snarky asshole, this movie has nothing for you. Absolutely nothing.
I can't wait to review this, and I spend the entire hour telling people how wonderful this movie is.
I'm sure you'll enjoy it, Mark.
All right, so let's get it done here, because I think we've said all that there is to say. You know, if you've got kids and you've enjoyed the first two movies, go see Kung Fu Panda. It was fun for the whole family.
It's the weakest of the three movies, I think. I'd have to seriously, you know, compare it to two, and I don't care to. But it's still fine. It's flashy and pretty enough to be entertaining for kids. There's enough bits of actual character development and story to keep the parents from wanting to smash their heads into the floor. And well, again, you know what you're getting with these. And it performs admirably with its relatively low expectations. So go ahead and see it. I imagine the next 2 weeks I will not be saying go ahead and see it.
Okay.
Because we got to review Pride and Prejudice and Zombies, and I have no hope. Absolutely none. I mean, look, I didn't even care that much for Abraham Lincoln Vampire Hunter, and this is the same type of thing. It's the same visual aesthetic, it's the same tone, it's the same everything.
Still haven't seen it.
Yeah, you're not missing much. And then the week after that is Deadpool, which I expect to... Ugh.
I'm going to see that on Valentine's Day. We got a whole thing set up for this. We have to get the babysitter all taken care of already. And so my wife and I, we're going to catch a matinee Deadpool. That's what we're doing for Valentine's Day. Then we're going to go to Jimmy Hula's for fancy tacos. And then I'm taking my wife to the Dolly Museum in St. Petersburg. Because I'm a good husband.
And once again, to anyone stalking Mark Radulich, he provides you his itinerary and just says, come get me.
I'm like Iron Man. I'm not afraid of you. Bring it on.
Yeah, because that ended so well for, you know, the people around him.
Well, eventually he got the bad guys and nobody died.
Yeah, another problem I have with those movies. Yeah, let's remove stakes. All right, so again, next week, Mark and I will be back reviewing Pride and Prejudice and Zombies. I'm going... It's going to be something, though. It'll be something. Maybe not very good, but it will be something. Then after that is Deadpool. And we're only reviewing Deadpool because the only other option is Zoolander 2, and I would rather douse my face in acid and then go into lime juice than watch Ben Stiller as Zoolander.
And because Deadpool's going to win the weekend, too.
Sure about that. There's a lot of idiots who... love Zoolander.
I will make you a shiny dollar bet, silver dollar bet, that one, Deadpool runs the weekend, two, Deadpool is phenomenal.
You would lose one of those. It's not going to be a good movie.
Says you.
Yes, the one with the fully functioning brain.
Ooh.
Tune in. That's... The Deadpool review could easily be one where Mark and I wind up yelling at each other. And those always make for good reviews.
So, in the spirit of Robin Winfrey yelling at me, the 10 best names for ducks. Number 10, a third Kevin. Number 9, Duck Ellington. Number 8, T-Bone. Number 7, Fat Kevin. Number 6, Sir Waddlesworth. Number 5, Webb Begley Jr. Number 4, Kevin. Number 3, Feather Flocklear. Number 2, Duck Cheney. And the number 1 best name for a duck is Admiral Quackbar.
The fact that somebody bothered to sit down and put that together.
Can I do my plugs now?
Real quick, what are we doing the week after Zoolander, the 19th? The weekend of the 19th. Do we have anything we're doing that time around, or are we skipping until...
I got you. Hang on now. Googly.
Well, what comes out after that is Race, Risen, and The Witch, and I'm not sure any of those are on our...
Here's the deal. We're doing Pride, Prejudice, and Zombie on the 10th. We're reviewing Deadpool on the 17th. We're skipping the 24th. We're skipping the 2nd. And we're reviewing Zootopia on the 9th.
Yeah.
We're skipping the 16th. We're reviewing Daredevil Season 2, the whole thing, on the 23rd. And on the 24th, we're doing In Defense of Man of Steel. And then on the 25th, I'm going to go see Batman vs. Superman, and Gavin's going to give you his case against Man of Steel. When we come back...
Gavin's going to be wishing it only got as bad as Man of Steel when he sees Dawn of Justice. I
don't think he's going to go see it.
Probably not. Look, I tried to... I actually like Man of Steel, and I'm going to... Yeah, Mark and I will be talking about that in depth the day before Dawn of Justice comes out. I have very little hope for Dawn of Justice. I have very little hope.
We'll be reviewing that on the 30th. And then we're skipping 2 weeks. We'll be reviewing The Jungle Book on the 20th of April. And then The Huntsman, Winter's War on the 27th. We're skipping the 4th. And then on May 11th, Captain America, skipping the 18th. Then we're doing the Angry Birds movie on the 25th. June 1st, the day before my birthday, Apocalypse, X-Men. And June 8th, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. I'll be reviewing that with Jesse Starcher and Teasley, I believe.
Yes. Anyone not me.
On the 15th, we'll be reviewing Warcraft. On the 22nd, Finding Dory. On the 29th, Independence Day. See, June is where things really get cooking.
Yeah,
that's where we're going to have a review.
Up until June, there's a lot of nothing.
So, and that's as much as I filled in the calendar at this point.
Yeah, we'll work out the rest of it later. I was just curious about the rest of this month. I'm trying to see if there's anything else that... I mean, I know there's nothing you're interested in. I'm trying to see if there's anything that I might be interested in. Yeah, probably not.
I sent you the damn calendar. You should have
figured
this out.
You did. I just didn't save it.
No, my point is you should have figured out if there was anything that you wanted to review. Okay, here's your choices.
I'm looking at them right now. We're probably good. If something really strikes my interest between now, we have weeks off. I'll figure it out as I go along if something else strikes my interest.
Gods of Egypt looks terrible.
Yes, it does. I think it was actually Eddie the Eagle I saw a preview for and went, huh. I mean, that's probably going to suck, but it might be the right kind of suck, you know?
Maybe if London Has Fallen came out a week earlier, I'd be up for that. But no,
yeah.
No thanks.
But nah, if it's that or Zootopia, it's Zootopia. I mean, that's not much of a stretch. All right. But with that, yeah, we're done. I think that's going to wrap us up. Again, if you have kids, you want to go see Kung Fu Panda 3, go see it. Or anyone with the intellect of a child. I say that not as an insult, but when I went to see this on Tuesday evening, I believe there were a couple of, grown men who had some kind of developmental issues who were very thoroughly entertained by Poe gassing out, trying to go up and down stairs. Which is a funny gag, by the way, but just saying, if you have anyone... Any children or someone with the intellect thereof will probably be thoroughly entertained by this. And if you're the one taking them, you won't want to gouge your eyes out. So big thumbs up as far as that goes.
Right now in the archives, we have our latest Metal Hammer of Doom. We've got a review of Megadeth by Dystopia by Megadeth. It was myself, Jesse Starcher, and Robert Cooper. Week before that. Now, real quick, this week, Long Road to Ruin, we will be talking about The Hobbit, but we are also going to pick up where we left off with the Return of the King, just because we had a Blog Talk Radio issue, which is essentially we can't go much past 2 hours anymore without it cutting us off. And that's what happened there is I did not budget for time.
Is that just their standard operating procedure now, or have you not heard back from them?
I haven't heard anything, but I'm going to assume.
Yeah, sure. Why should they devote customer service to people who actually pay for this?
Yeah. I'm just assuming that
any other services that, you know, would any other websites that would provide this same service that want to talk, call Mark. We wouldn't be averse to finding, you know, another service. Just throwing it out there.
So that being said, we got cut off in mid-discussion of Return of the King. So we'll spend a few minutes wrapping up that discussion, myself, Sean Comer, and Andrew Graham. And then we'll jump into The Hobbit, all three movies. It'll be a two-hour discussion, no more, no less. And then after that, what do we got going on? We got on February 11th. We'll be celebrating Black History Month here, another dose of Long Road to Ruin with the original three Shaft movies.
I can't believe there were three.
On the 18th, Metal Hammer of Doom will be reviewing Avantasia's Ghost Lights. And then Black History Month continues on February 25th with Beverly Hills Cop Trilogy. So
there's a series that peaked real early.
So that's what we'll be looking at in the month of February. And that's all I got.
Shaft movies. You have to open that show with the bit from The Simpsons where Bart and Lisa sing the Shaft theme.
I'll see what I can do.
Because there's an episode, the same episode where, I forget its title, but Homer eats fugu and he believes he's eaten the poisoned fish and spends the last day of what is supposed to be the last day of his life. It's a solid enough episode, but they're at a karaoke sushi bar, and Bart and Lisa sing the Shaft theme song on karaoke.
He's a bad mother, shut your mouth.
Yeah, so I'm insisting that when you open that after your usual theme, that's the sound bite we get.
I'll see what I can do once again.
All right. As for me, I'm normally found in the MMA zone of 411mania.com. I'm actually thinking about writing something tomorrow. It'll be the first time in a long time I've written something that wasn't live coverage. But watching Ryan Bader get violently knocked out by Anthony Johnson just filled me with such simultaneous glee at watching Bader fall, because I don't care much for Bader as a fighter. Never met him personally. I can't say anything good or bad about him as a person. As a fighter, he tends to bore me to tears. But that's also just reminded me how crappy the 205-pound division is right now. So I kind of want to write about that. This Saturday, I have live coverage of UFC Fight Night 82. Johnny Hendricks will be taking on Stephen Thompson in the main event. It's a really solid free TV card, guys. There's a couple of great flyweight fights, and for some reason, there's a heavyweight fight between Roy Nelson and Jared Rosholt.
Woo!
Even Mark, don't. Even you can't defend that.
Who is it again? I wasn't listening.
Roy Nelson and Jared Rosholt.
Jared Rosholt's going to get his head knocked off.
No. See, Roy Nelson's wrestling defense is kind of weak. He's going to get taken down and laid on for 3 rounds, and I'm going to want to kill myself all over again.
You said that a lot this episode. You're starting to worry me.
Those two have worse cardiovascular training than Poe does.
Hey, better bring it back.
Panda asthma. Yeah, panda asthma too, huh? Is that running the family? Oh, stairs. All right. Every Sunday at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, I host the 411 Ground and Pound radio show. Last week, we looked back at UFC on Fox 18. Again, Anthony Johnson knocks out Ryan Bader, and there was much rejoicing. Ben Rothwell submitted Josh Barnett. Most surreal thing I've ever seen in MMA, apart from Fedor tapping. Just, really? Rothwell is going to tap Barnett anyway. This week we'll be reviewing UFC Fight Night 82, and that's it, actually. There's not a preview. We'll be back the week after to preview something. We'll probably talk about Benson Henderson moving to Bellator, because it saddens me. It really does. I miss watching Ben Henderson, and I don't watch Bellator on principle. But he'll probably be live cage side to cut a promo during that awful, awful card that's coming from Texas in a couple of weeks that Mark's going to cover for me, because my sanity can only take so much. And a double main event of Ken Shamrock versus Hoist Gracie and Kimbo Slice versus whatever 200. I can't do it. I just can't do it.
Dada 3000, I think his name is.
Whatever. I really don't care. Nobody cares. But Mark has graciously decided to save my sanity for that night, and he'll be covering that, so I thank you in advance, and I will thank you after the fact as well.
No problem.
And I'm going to laugh when at least one of those fights, if not both, falls out between now and then due to injury. Or they all fight injured, and they just actually need crutches to get to the cage. I'm okay with either of those. All right. But that's it. That's going to wrap us up here. Thanks for listening. Kung Fu Panda 3, really solid family fun movie. As an adult, you won't hate it, and the kids seem to have been enjoying it so far. So, success financially, success creatively, good on everybody there. And again, they're planning 3 sequels. I was not joking. There are going to be 3 more of these. Not sure what they're going to do, but they're making money, so good on them. All right. For Mark Radulich, I'm Robert Winfree, reminding everybody out there once again to continue to be well, be safe, and behave. And as always, when we leave you on our movie reviews, we leave you with the soundtrack to every Hollywood executive's life.